want to do number three as well, or just number two?
Maybe just number two, because we might have to put up the stand.
No, no, that's fine. Let me get it ready.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, please rise for the academic procession and the Chancellor.
I declare that the 563rd Convocation of McMaster University for the conferring of degrees is now in session.
Please be seated. Good morning. I am Dr. David Wilkinson, Provost and Vice President Academic. This morning I have the great pleasure of acting as your Master of Ceremonies and welcoming you, graduands and guests, to this convocation ceremony. I would like to start by acknowledging that we meet today on the traditional territories of the Mississauga and Haudenosaunee nations and within the lands protected by the Dish with One Spoon Wampum Agreement. I would also like to take this opportunity to acknowledge some of the notable leaders joining me on the stage today. Dr. Suzanne LaBarge, our Chancellor, Dr. Patrick Dean, President and Vice Chancellor, Mr. Roger Coldry, Vice President, Administration, Dr. Doug Welsh, Acting Associate Vice President and Dean of Graduate Studies, Dean of the Faculty of Engineering, Ishwar Puri, Dean, Acting Dean of the Faculty of Science, Bruce Milliken, as well as Assistant Vice Presidents, Associate Deans, Chairs, Directors, Faculty Members, and honored guests. Before we start our formal program, may I ask everyone in the room to please switch off any electronic device that may ring or beep during the ceremony. I would now like to call upon our Chancellor, Dr. Suzanne LaBarge, to make her own welcoming remarks.
Welcome, honored guests, staff, faculty, families, friends, and most importantly, graduates. This is an exciting day for all of you who are graduating today, as well as for all those people who have supported you and stood behind you, and in many cases have had a key role in you being here today. You've achieved a great deal to get here, and you should all be very proud of your success and looking forward to what the future might bring. Congratulations, and enjoy the ceremony.
I would now like to introduce Dr. Patrick Dean, President and Vice Chancellor, who will be presenting our honorary degree recipients.
Chancellor LaBarge, by the authority of the Senate of McMaster University, I have the honor to present Shaoxin Chen. Dr. Shaoxin Chen is an emeritus professor of applied radiation physics in the Department of Nuclear Science and Engineering at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, where he has been a member of the faculty since 1968. He is also a McMaster alumnus who earned his PhD in 1964, working under the supervision of Nobel laureate Bertram Brockhaus, after earning graduate degrees at the University of Michigan and the National Tsinghua University. Dr. Chen's groundbreaking work has included investigations into the properties of disordered materials and supercooled and interfacial water using neutron scattering and other related scattering techniques. The co-author of more than 415 research publications, he has successfully designed and implemented novel experimental techniques and extended the frontiers of neutron, X-ray, and laser spectroscopy. His research includes photon correlation spectroscopy studies of critical dynamics of a binary liquid mixture and neutron scattering studies of the thermodynamics and dynamics of confined water in supercooled states near hydrophilic and hydrophobic surfaces. He has also made significant contributions to the study of hydrogen storage by exploring the uses of activated carbon to allow the element to be stored at room temperature. He contributed significantly to the development of photon correlation spectroscopy, or PCS, and in 1970 constructed the first 128-channel digital photon correlator in the United States. Dr. Chen has held an impressive series of international appointments over the last 5 decades. He spent time in the neutron physics division of the legendary Chalk River Laboratories, then was an assistant professor at the University of Waterloo. He held visiting positions with the Atomic Energy Research Establishment at Harwell in England and with the Division of Applied Science at Harvard University. He joined MIT as an assistant professor in 1968, becoming a professor in 1974. He served in that capacity until 2008, when he became professor emeritus. Dr. Chen has been a visiting professor or fellow at more than a dozen institutions around the world, including the Academia Sinica in Beijing, École Supérieure de Physique et Chimie de Paris, the University of Constance in Germany, the University of Bordeaux, the Argonne National Lab in Illinois, Kyoto University in Japan, and the National Tsinghua University of Taiwan. He received the 2008 Clifford G. Shull Prize for Excellence in Neutron Science, the 2015 Guinier Prize for Excellence in Small Angle Neutron Scattering, and the Alexander von Humboldt U.S. Senior Scientist Award. He is a fellow of the American Physical Society, the American Association for the Advancement of Science, the Neutron Scattering Society of America, and the Japan Society for the Promotion of Science. The University of Messina, Italy, awarded Dr. Chen an honorary degree in 2014, and he has also been named an academician of the Academia Sinica and received the Career Achievement Award from MIT. Today, Madam Chancellor, I present Dr. Sao Xin Chen to you so that McMaster University may pay tribute to his considerable contributions to science and to his profession by conferring upon him his second McMaster degree, on this occasion, the degree Doctor of Science, honoris causa.
Sao Xin Chen, by the authority of McMaster University Senate, I have the great pleasure to confer upon you the degree Doctor of Science, honoris causa, in McMaster University, with all the rights and privileges pertaining to that degree. Congratulations. I'll get you to sign this. And Dr. Chen, we'd be delighted if you'd say a few words to the graduates.
Madam Chancellor and President Dean, I accept this honoris causa with great honor and humility. I studied at McMaster for 2 years from 1962 to 64 to earn my PhD degree in physics under the late Professor B.N. Brockhaus, a Nobel laureate in physics. Professor Brockhaus is my first mentor in neutron physics, from whom I learned the essence of the neutron triple axis spectroscopy. I was so lucky that his mentoring has such a long-lasting impact on my entire career, including the last 47 years at MIT. For this, I wish to thank my alma mater most sincerely. Graduates, I want to congratulate each of you receiving your degree today for your impressive accomplishment. What an important importance today for your career. Still, this is just the beginning for your important milestone, for your tremendous future. Wherever you go and whatever you do, I hope you will remember what you have, your mentor has instilled in you, in McMaster. Congratulations.
Chancellor LaBarge, by the authority of the Senate of McMaster University, I have the honor to present Truman Goba. An outstanding civil engineer who has contributed to his profession both in his native South Africa and internationally, Truman Goba has previously been honored by McMaster's Faculty of Engineering with the Engineering Leadership Award. Mr. Goba was born in Durban, South Africa, during the apartheid years. His path to becoming a prominent engineer, entrepreneur, and community leader began at Madikoti College, where he earned his survey technician's diploma before completing his Bachelor of Science Engineering degree at the University of Natal in 1979, becoming the first black South African to graduate in engineering from that university. Mr. Goba then went to work as an engineer with Keeves Stain Inc., and then at Tron Burke and Isaac, before coming to the United States to complete his master's degree in civil engineering at Cornell University. In 1990, Mr. Goba was inspired by Nelson Mandela's release from prison. He left the private sector to work with the Rural Advice Center in Johannesburg on developing infrastructure projects designed to improve living standards for black South Africans. In 1993, Mr. Goba founded his own consulting practice, which became Goba Motlhole and Associates, Inc., a multidisciplinary engineering firm. In 2001, the firm merged with Keeves Stain to become Goba Proprietary Limited, with Mr. Goba serving as executive chairman. In 2013, Goba Limited merged with the Canadian global engineering firm Hatch, and Mr. Goba now serves as chairman of Hatch Goba in South Africa. Mr. Goba, who is an expert in tunnels, bridges, roads, and water and sanitation infrastructure, has been extremely active in his profession, serving on the Engineering Council of South Africa, including 2 years as president, beginning in 2007. He was elected president of the South African Institution of Civil Engineers in 2002 and served as chairman of the Cement and Concrete Institute. From 2004 to 2007, he was a member of the Construction Industry Development Board. He is also an active member of the University of KwaZulu-Natal Foundation at his undergraduate alma mater. Mr. Goba's strong connection with KwaZulu-Natal sparked his vision for the Gateway to Africa partnership that connects that institution with McMaster University. Mr. Goba has played an important role in the long-term development of his home nation through his appointment to the South African National Development Commission. He is, of course, a registered professional engineer as well as a fellow of the South African Institute of Civil Engineering and a fellow of the South African Academy of Engineering. He has also received the Lifetime Achievement Award for Excellence in Engineering from the South African Professional Services Awards. Madam Chancellor, Truman Gober is a trailblazer whose combined work as an engineer, an entrepreneur, and a community leader has made important contributions both to his profession and to the healthy development of a home nation once dramatically and famously torn apart and held back by apartheid. I present Mr. Gober to you today so that McMaster may recognize his achievements and contributions by conferring upon him the degree Doctor of Science, honoris causa.
Truman Gober, by the authority of McMaster University Senate, I have the great pleasure to confer upon you the degree Doctor of Science, honoris causa, in McMaster University, with all the rights and privileges pertaining to that degree. Congratulations. And I would now like to invite Dr. Gober to deliver the convocation address.
Madam Chancellor, President and Vice Chancellor at McMaster University, Dr. Patrick Dean, Deans of Faculties, members of the university community, students, parents, honored guests, ladies and gentlemen, to say that I'm honored by the conferral of this at DSC honoris causa by one of the top universities in the world really feels like an understatement. As the name of the degree implies, the university has found it appropriate, in my case, to waive the usual requirements for admission, and I'm most thankful for the privilege. I've met students this week. I'm reminded of a simple saying attributed to Thomas Edison, and you may be aware of it. If we did all the things we were capable of doing, we would literally astound ourselves. And I must tell you, this served as a great motivator for my life. I can assure you that it wasn't likely that I would end up achieving and being honored to the extent that I have been honored today. When I grew up in townships around Durban and where I was born and raised, a story on how I got to study to become an engineer starts with a certain Dr. Steyn, born of Afrikaner parents in a small town called Morgenzon on the banks of the Osprey River near Swaziland. Kivi Steyn did well at university and he got a scholarship to study overseas at Harvard and MIT. Dr. Steyn died on 5 September this year at the age of 93. My connection is that he had established a consulting engineering firm known as Kivi Steyn and Partners during apartheid, and at some stage in 1975, on hearing about me having obtained the survey technician's diploma, as to how come it was that there was no place at universities for black people to study engineering. Who was going to manage operations in the townships where black people lived? Water supply systems, waste disposal, transport. So they spoke to the head of civil engineering at the University of Natal at the time, who in turn promised to write to the Minister of Education in Pretoria. The consequence of that was that 40 years ago this year, I received the good news that I'd been granted permission by government to study for BSc engineering at the University of Natal in Durban. I cannot get into detail on the challenges. One challenge, for example, was that being admitted at university did not mean that I could live on campus, which was in an area then designated for white people. Nor could I board a white bus which serviced the white area where the university is situated at the top of the ridge in Durban. Nevertheless, I appreciated the bursary, but it was more than the bursary. Vacation work meant that I needed to be accommodated somewhere. And even simple things like where I could have lunch or where, which toilets to use and so on. Kivistain were most supportive. I cannot pretend that I found studying in those circumstances easy. It was extremely difficult, especially staying at what was a colored township of Fosterville and having to walk a long distance downhill to the bus, to the black bus route, and back up the next morning to Howard College on the top of the hill. As a friend has put it, sometimes in life you reach a hill and you realize that the only way to get to the other side is to climb this hill in front of you. You must then decide, this is the hill for me to climb, and then simply do it. Otherwise, you fail. The result is that one day in January 1980, many in South Africa woke up to hear on radio and read in newspapers across the country that one student had become the first black person to complete his engineering studies at the university. This brought great excitement and pride to me, my family, and my community. I truly felt like a hero that day. This publicity continued until graduation 3 months later. Even today, I've had people show me pictures cut out of those newspapers, articles in those years. Many years later, in 1993, after the master's degree at Cornell and some work at Baltimore, Maryland, I returned to South Africa, soon joined by Ebenezer Mwahludi, who worked for the Rural Advice Center. And he had graduated at the other university of Witwatersrand. We learned quickly about starting a business, how to recruit, how to look after employees, how to let them participate, how to create and maintain projects, pipelines, and so on, how to build the company and build its reputation. Relief came for us in 1994 when the first democratic elections in South Africa came. We grew quickly to 50 employees, and 8 years later, the company merged with Kivistain, my original employer. And successful, driven by the passion to obtain results, best solutions, and advice to clients, and delivering projects to meet expectations. 8 years later, we merged the company into Hatch, which has become a global group of consulting engineers, construction and project managers. Today, Hatch continues to do its work and is growing throughout the big continent of Africa, a process that is irreversible. As far as South Africa is concerned, meanwhile, life changed completely and will never be the same again. We live in a true democracy in terms of human rights. There is no comparison to where we came from, thanks to leaders like Nelson Mandela, Oliver Tambo, and others. I feel honored today, especially also that I was asked to say these few words in front of so many students, parents, friends of the McMaster University community, whose mission each year is to produce people that the world needs. One other thing, to graduates, always remember to appreciate all that these individuals have done to help you prepare for the world you'll soon be facing. Our expectations of you may be high. However, you can never be aware of what your actual achievements will have been in 40 years' time. All we are certain of is that it will be a different world again to what we know today. My estimate is that you will also do the things that you are capable of doing, and that you will look back in 40 years and be amazed at what you will have achieved. I wish this to happen to you. It has happened to me. Thank you for the award of this degree and for the listening to me this morning. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Goba, for that speech. Dr. Goba is a wonderful example of what an individual who's got perseverance and intelligence can accomplish in a world where not everybody has access to the kind of education that we have taken for granted. His career is remarkable, his experience, something that I think very few of us understand, and we are absolutely delighted to be able to include him today in the McMaster family. Thank you, Dr. Goba.
Dr. Patrick Dean will now come forward to present the graduands to our Chancellor for admission to their degrees.
Will the graduands please stand? Madam Chancellor, on behalf of McMaster University Senate, I present to you these candidates in order that you may confer the appropriate degrees upon them, and I bear witness that they are worthy and suitable. May I also request that you confer the appropriate degrees in absentia upon all those candidates who have successfully completed the required course of study, but who are not present.
Graduands, by my authority and that of the McMaster University Senate, I have the great pleasure to admit to those before me today and those in absentia to their individual degrees in McMaster University with all of the rights and privileges pertaining to those degrees. My sincere congratulations to you all. Please be seated.
Graduates, I now ask each of you to join me on stage so that the Chancellor and I may welcome you to the McMaster community of scholars. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, so that each graduate's name may be heard, it would be appreciated if during the presentation of the graduates, you would hold your collective applause to the end of each degree category. Thank you. Madam Chancellor, may I present to you the following graduates of the degree Doctor of Philosophy. Alexander Hooper. Renee Jeanette Saint-Anjou. Alireza Akbari. Cheryl Droshek. Christine Gabardo. Tianyi Goa. Salma Ali Kamria. Andrew King. Eamon Zlitny. Yanin Kao. Jafar Hussein Gauss. Mohammed Zamri Zamaludjin. Vida Midanshani. Jacob Ness. Chinadu Oboorai Okoli. Maria Ovana. David McLeod. Talana Rabaran. Lucas Sadowski. Yasser Mohammed Alaanini. Arash Olia. Eshan Tagavi. Gangning Tan. Mirda Alamzadeh. Nirja Maskar. Sally Redisic.
Zheng Dong. Hao Ji. Ran Gu. Hanan Hassanain. Royshu Hall. Haibo Liang. Fei Peng. Aditya Ravichandran. Kurt Jason Lorenz Stoll. Pawadi Agyekum. Lee Ha. Nancy LaMonica. Kinga Laura Eliezaz. Jeff Graham. Brian Jude Martin. Amei S.M. Shyam. Henry So. Abdel Rahman Abdel Fattah. Song Chen. Simon Peter Bechera. Jason Boulay. Connie Chang. Carolina Oremos. Thomas Fabian Sablich. Mary Zuriel. Ashkan Dagan Kushkazi. Mikhail Klassen. Amanda Marie Beers. Laura Kathleen Chirelli Aimbau. Jordan Lass. Vivian Lee. Fiona Christina Manning. Aaron McCallum. Brandon Tyler Paul. Derek John Kappen. Sahar Darvish Mola. Charles W. Mitz. Xiaopei Shi.
Madam Chancellor, may I present to you the following graduates of the degree Master of Science. Stephen Raymond Botts. Dugu Cevic. Gregory Anthony DeSanza. Amanda Mary Garvin. Christine Marie Hamill. Angus Ho. Michael Yu Ting Lim. Paul Natali. Yasser Gamal Salama. Sharok Shekariz. Sridevi Bhaskaran. Helen Elizabeth Brown. Thulasi Yegathesan. Hongsheng Zhong. Gabriel Anthony Arcuri. Allison Lynn Brown. Felix Chun Chung Chang. Mark D'Alessandro. Caitlin Daly. Sydney Jean Louise Duggan. Kesia Angela Lee. Rebecca Lee. Cameron McCann. Jessica Sara Laura Rastelli. Haley Spinato. Sadia Yawar. Baharak Hadinya. Mary Catherine Allison. Damiana Milicevic. Marie Iris Barnhill. Matthew Brandt. Madeline Elaine Hill. Graham Thomas Robert Kuiper. Sonia Minas. Yasaman Moe Seniahue. Ismail Safaya Adakani. Yunan Wang. Han Zhang. Yuncheng Zhao. Kaelin Savoy. Michael Birch. Niloufar Javed Khalili. Megan Mikulich. Gordon van der Voda. Julian Kazem Gulum. Lucas Greville. Sari Eisenstein. Martin Blaustein. Amanda Bowman. Jonathan Earl. Feng He. Bishnu Katuwal. Nidhi Patel. Maria Elisa Reyes. Ken Tring. Madam Chancellor, may I present to you the following graduates of the degree Master of Applied Science. Sajjad Afraz. Sondos Ayash. Omar Borselli. Emily Rose Creighton. Helen Elizabeth Dorrington. Samuel Brian Norman Grimshaw. Brian McDonald. Nicole Mangiacote. Robin Karen Ng. James Alexander Scott. Natalie Colantonio. Clinton Troy D'Souza.
Michael Kovacs. Scott Anthony Lynn. Connor Worschak.
Where are the rest of my cards?
Matthew Stephen Zemmett.
Down there.
Michael Yule. Hyaying Zhang. Who did we miss? Lucas McCurley. Xiao Wang. Chenyu Yang. Yuyang Zhou. Buyang Hosseini Vugagarsha. Justin Ridosh. Fadi George Basmaji. Darren Fenstra. Muraladin Haran Kumar. Dan Lo. Tanshi Zhang. Yua Fu. Jeffrey Gerard. Dana George Margosh. SM Hamdi Sadiq. Timothy Johnston. Alexander Shep. Madam Chancellor, may I present to you the following graduates of the degree Master of Engineering. Xiao Dong. Michael Rowinski. Selena Rickley. Nanan Osi Ade. Sarah Sarita Mashi. Madam Chancellor, may I present to you the following graduates of the degree Master of Engineering Design. Fasul Ali. Vincent David Appet. Nawal Bihai. Anju Bora. Stephen Joseph Cabral. Fatima Zahra Chakir. Kay Chen. Kay King Cheng. Liang Dong Chen. Zeming Fang. Jifu Goa. Faisal Ja'ali. Jenbo Zhe. Hei Kang. Sonasasian Kahania Jigdhwana. Jaden Libersback. Siuma. Oliver Kalon Maynard. Worki Minoipia. Shoya Mu. Kiran Kumar Naran. Oba Orai Wana Okort. Quarter. Omar Anthony Orr. Sarkis Patis. Ali Saeed Mahdi Sheikh. Kampreet Singh. Binal Meshkurma Solanki. Robert Douglas Steele. Abhimanyu Thakur. Vyamsi Krishna Vadi. Robert John Van Gemenian. Hei Xu. Chen Zhao. Gang Yu Zhou. Linan Xiang. Madam Chancellor, may I present to you the following graduates of the degree Master of Engineering in Public Policy. Jieqing Gao. Syed Zayim Zakizmi. Mayhem Masood Sadiq. Brandon Sarju. Obaid Ulia Shah. Lickham Wang. Ting Ting Zhu. Madam Chancellor, may I present to you the following graduate of the degree Masters of Engineering in Manufacturing Engineering. Milovan Silvojevic. Or Silvojevic, damn it.
Madam Chancellor, may I present to you the following graduates of the degree Bachelor of Science Honours. Rishveer Singh Bangal. Magdalena Boyle. Victoria Louise Boyd. Zara Jessica Tresvales Cabanis. Amanpreet Chima. Laura Leslie Evans. Joanna Teresa Florica. Iman Jama. Courtney Marie Johnson. Labib Khan. Samantha Kotick. Yes, Tri Tang Dai Lei. Jeffrey Leung. Ian Michael James Lewis. Alexandra Teresa McDonald. Alexandra Ellen May McDonald. Michael Evan Medeiros. Maham Pervez. Mark Pupula Pillai. Karen Seth. Mariam Shahzad. Teresa Warriner. Xu Ai Zhang. Wen Tao Zheng. Leanne Zubovsky. Madam Chancellor, Madam Chancellor, may I present to you the following graduates of the degree Bachelor of Science, Kinesiology Honours. Nicholas Manuel André. Shannon Charlton. Muaz Zahid. Mm-hmm. Madam Chancellor, may I present to you the following graduates of the degree Bachelor of Science. Naba Abdul Jabbar. Mohammed Hatem Jbara. Taylor Irene Lee. Xin Ning. Ryan John Peters. Joanne Rajanayagam. Madam Chancellor, may I present to you the following graduate of the degree Bachelor of Medical Radiation Sciences, Yi Jing.
Madam Chancellor, may I present to you the following graduate of the degree Bachelor of Engineering and Management, Ahmad Walid Naimi. Madam Chancellor, may I present to you the following graduate of the degree Bachelor of Engineering and Society, Oluwadamilola Oiro. Yasin Strinic. Madam Chancellor, may I present to you the following graduates of the degree Bachelor of Engineering, Maruf Hossein, Walid Irfan, Michael Reagan Legger, Anis Raghunathan, Mohammed Usama Rahimzada, Padamjit Sandhu, Tong Wu, Madam Chancellor, may I present to you the following graduate of the degree Bachelor of Applied Science, Ehsan Ullah, Madam Chancellor, may I present to you the following graduates of the degree Bachelor of Technology, Morgan Anderson, Adrian Beatty, Ryan James Beauregard, Paul Brown, Alan Geldart, Dominic Grandoni, Pardeep Singh Grewal, Nasco Ivanov. Vikas Jindal. Diana Kinaya. Adam Avinash Lachman. Samuel Kevin Pelkowitz. Navjot Pelia. Jackson Kwong. Samir Rai. Nadeem Rematullah. Brandon Sachs. Sukhchain Singh Sambalu. Nitika Sharma. Edison Sinani. Varinder Singh. Cheng Jang.
Madam Chancellor, may I present to you the following recipient of the Graduate Diploma in University Network of Excellence in Nuclear Engineering. Frode Kalida.
So please join me in giving one more round of applause to all of the newest graduates of the class of 2016. So ladies and gentlemen, I would now like to introduce Dr. Talina Rambaran, someone I have had the personal pleasure of working with in her role as president of the Graduate Students Association, now a PhD graduate in chemistry, who will be delivering the valedictory address.
Good morning. Chancellor LaBarge, President Dean, Provost Wilkinson, McMaster faculty, distinguished guests, friends and family, and most importantly, the Science and Engineering class of 2016. I am honored to be here today to address my fellow graduates. Today marks the culmination of a lot of hard work in the pursuit of a higher education, whether it's a couple of years for those completing a master's degree, 4 years for those completing a bachelor's degree, or a large number of years I would prefer not to disclose to complete a doctorate degree, we're all joined here to celebrate a great accomplishment. We did it. We made it to the finish line. It's easy to sometimes take for granted what an achievement this really is. Every day, we go to school surrounded by thousands of other students who are also pursuing a university education. But to put it into perspective, in the world, less than 7% of the population holds a university degree. We are all now a part of that privileged minority, graduating with a degree from McMaster, one of the best universities in the world. While each of us was the leader of our own individual journey, putting in the hard work necessary to make it here today, it wouldn't be possible without the support we received from those around us from the great professors who challenged and inspired us, to the friends and family who encouraged us, and to the peers who walked through this journey with us, sharing in our successes or lending an ear to vent our stresses, we thank you. And now here we are, in this bittersweet moment in time, thrilled to have completed our degrees, but also nostalgic about our time as a McMaster student coming to an end. Could this really be the last time we see the leaves change on our beautiful campus, or the last time we gather at the Phoenix? We are faced with a big question mark of what's to come next in our lives. The future can fill people with both excitement and trepidation. Maybe you know exactly where your path will take you, or maybe you're still unsure of what you want to be when you grow up. But one thing is for certain, you all have bright futures ahead of you. And even though we may be moving on from this place that was like a second home, we will always carry the fond memories of our time on campus in our maroon-colored hearts. Our time at McMaster has prepared us for the next stage in life and has taught us so much. And I'm not just talking about the knowledge and skills learned in the classroom and lab, or that ability to find free food on campus and at conferences that students managed to perfect over the years. We learned how to persevere through challenges and failures. In the long run, that less than desirable grade or committee meeting wasn't the end of the world, and it did not prevent us from succeeding or define us as a person. We learned how resilient we could be, finishing school while still facing all of the other challenges that life throws our way. We learned how to work with others, how to manage our time, the value of caffeine, and how productive we could be at 3 a.m. when we had an 8 a.m. deadline. And notably, we learned how to find creative solutions to problems and how to think critically about what we were learning and the world around us. Though everyone's experience is a little bit different, the one thing we share in common is we are all an older and wiser version of the person we were when we first walked through McMaster's doors. We can use what we have learned, both in and out of the classroom, to be engaged citizens of the world. A professor of entrepreneurship told our multidisciplinary class that our education and the skills we have gained are great human capital in the world. This is something that has stuck with me. We all have the knowledge and the ability to make a difference and contribute to the rapidly changing world around us. Technology is advancing, and there are opportunities to play a part in this progress. The world also faces many challenges. Sustainability, renewable energy, the refugee crisis, social justice issues. We are continually inundated with information about the difficulties our world and our communities are facing. You, the class of 2016, are the future leaders and intellectuals. Our actions over the next years will shape the world we live in. Wherever your path takes you, be engaged citizens, be the problem solvers, the innovators, and the critical thinkers to positively contribute to society. There are no bounds to the great things that can be accomplished by those among us today. Don't be afraid of failure or feel that you cannot make a difference. Go into the world with passion, following your dreams. You will never know what you can achieve until you try. As T.S. Eliot said, only those who will risk going too far can possibly find out how far one can go. Class of 2016, congratulations, you've earned this. Thank you.
Thank you, Chelina. May I now call upon Dr. Douglas Welsh, Acting Associate Vice President and Dean of Graduate Studies, who will present the Governor General's Academic Medal.
Madam Chancellor, Jake Neese is this year's recipient of the Governor General's Academic Medal. This medal is awarded annually to the graduate student with the highest academic standing during the academic year. I ask that you and all those present join with me to express our recognition of his achievement.
Congratulations on your achievements, Jake. May I now call upon Karen McQuaig of the McMaster Alumni Association to deliver the alumni address.
Chancellor LaBarge, President Dean, McMaster faculty, fellow alumni, honored guests, and especially members of the McMaster class of 2016. The first time we did this, it was 122 years ago, and there were 16 of you. The events of commencement, as convocation was known then, were a little different from today's ceremony. In 1894, McMaster's first convocation included a sermon, the reading of graduate thesis, yes, they read them aloud, word for word, and, wait for it, the conferring of 60 honorary degrees. The black graduation gowns back then were made of alpaca and lined with white satinette for the arts grads and lavender for the graduates of theology. One of the graduates wearing alpaca that day was a young woman named Elizabeth Wells. She later published a description of the ceremony in Canadian Magazine. In that article, she wrote of McMaster's first convocation. The enthusiasm shown by the students who sat massed in the body of a large assembly showed plainly that they were filled with the spirit of loyalty to their university. I'm not sure if 16 people in alpaca gowns counts as a mass, but the feelings of enthusiasm and pride were likely valid observations. I hope you have similar feelings today. I know I did when I graduated from Mac. Today, our university is very different from the McMaster Elizabeth Wells knew 122 years ago, and our institutional history and credentials are far more robust. Today, I hope that your McMaster has earned your enthusiasm and loyalty through its service, excellence, leadership, and accomplishment, just as you have worked hard to earn our pride in you and our loyalty to you as you become newest members of the McMaster alumni family. The McMaster Alumni Association's goal is to take your connection to McMaster beyond the feelings that are so strong today and help to make it into a lifelong connection of substance. In your lives as alumni, the association will work to keep you connected. You will receive the McMaster Times Alumni Magazine, the newsletter, Maroon Mail, and you can always be part of our McMaster communities in the digital space. As graduates, you will sample activities and opportunities from our Mac 10 program, a series of events and services, including social activities, career assistance, and online and in-person networking. We've also added a mentoring program that gives you access to the wisdom of hundreds of fellow Mac grads, as well as the opportunity to share your wisdom with current students through a searchable database. Throughout your life, you can take advantage of value-added services like home, auto, and life insurance, mortgages, credit cards, and travel services. And you can also join your fellow alumni at one of the hundreds of events we organize annually in Hamilton, across Canada, and around the world. There's much more information at alumni.mcmaster.ca. All you really need to know for now, however, is that the McMaster Alumni Association and the Mac alumni family can be part of your McMaster experience, in a big way or a small way, anytime you'd like. When you're ready, we'll be ready to see you too. So, to the class of 2016, I offer my most sincere congratulations on your academic accomplishments and on your graduation. You should be extremely proud of your accomplishments. I certainly am. Congratulations, and welcome to the Mac alumni family.
Thank you, Karen. May I invite Dr. Dean back to the podium to deliver his president's address.
Madam Chancellor, honored guests, colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, and especially today's graduates. Your valedictorian, Talina, spoke eloquently about the ways in which, as you move on from McMaster, you can be a force for good in the world. And I want to pick up on that theme and say a little bit more about the world into which you are going. And I want to begin by taking note of an article that appeared recently in a magazine. Some of you, or certainly some of your parents, will occasionally dip into. This is The Economist. Art of the Lie is the title of a recent essay in The Economist, one which poses the question, politicians have always lied. Does it matter if they leave the truth behind entirely? And the question takes us back to the 19th century Irish writer Oscar Wilde, who in a famous essay called The Decay of Lying, this was in 1889, criticized politicians for not being good enough liars, precisely because they lacked what he called, and here's a quote from him, the superb irresponsibility, the natural disdain of proof of any kind that characterizes the true liar. And the true liar, in Wilde's tongue-in-cheek view, is the consummate artist, the progressive undermining of fact and proof, an indication to him that, as he said, a new renaissance in art is imminent. Now, these are the sentiments that defined a late Victorian cultural movement known as aestheticism, one in which the imagination and its works were argued to be superior to anything discoverable in nature or amenable to empirical inquiry. Thus, writes Wilde, another quote, if a man is sufficiently unimaginative to produce evidence in support of a lie, he might just as well speak the truth at once. The lies of politicians, at least those that do not leave the truth behind entirely, are not worth the telling, and probably worse in his view than what he called dull fact. That's a long quote from Wilde. Now, to understand the point of Wilde's witty argument in that essay, The Decay of Lying, you need to know something of the time in which he was writing, and in particular, the extent to which in the late 1800s, with the institutionalization of statistics, the derivation of systematic knowledge from descriptions of observed particulars was becoming the dominant epistemology. Wilde's essay, and indeed his entire career, must be understood as a reaction, always a satirical reaction, against an emerging world order in which the fact, particularly as conceived in quantifiable and observable terms, was becoming dominant. It was, in other words, a protest against the kind of worldview which today, especially in the university setting and especially in the sciences and engineering, we take for granted. I'd like to go back to the question posed by The Economist and think about recent history, in which political and policy issues have been increasingly decided with apparent indifference to considerations of truth or fact. Now, I speak about recent history, and of course you will all be thinking about last week's presidential election in the United States. But that was part of a trend identified as early as 2004, when Ralph Keyes published a book entitled The Post-Truth Era, Dishonesty and Deception in Contemporary Life. Then in 2010, David Roberts coined the term post-truth politics to identify an approach to political debate in which there is an appeal to emotion altogether disconnected from fact or evidence, an approach which vitiates traditional debate entirely by dismissing the truth as of secondary importance at best and as irrelevant at worst. And then this past August, writing in the pages of the New York Times, William Davies declared finally this: we have entered an age of post-truth politics. Then, to my astonishment, having completed drafting these notes a few days before, yesterday came the news that the Oxford English Dictionary has proclaimed that word, post-truth, the word of the year. Why? Because use of the term has increased by 2,000% in 2016 over the year before. That's a barometer of the state of our culture. Now, lest we're tempted to think that the descent into post-truth is an exclusively American phenomenon, Davies finds examples in the Brexit campaign in the United Kingdom and in political controversies elsewhere, as in the surprising political traction achieved by climate change deniers, for example. If Davies is to be believed, then, Oscar Wilde has had his wish, and political life in the second decade of the 21st century has in some sense become art. Instead of taking its cue from what Wilde called the dull facts of life as they are lived and experienced and observed, politics bends the facts to its will in a spirit of fearlessness and, as Wilde memorably put it, superb irresponsibility. The period in which Wilde wrote is known as the decadence, and it is perhaps helpful to think of our contemporary post-truth world as a new decadence. Like its 19th century precursor, not only indifferent to empirical fact, but also contemptuous of the ethical and moral constraints that accrue when we acknowledge the existence of truths over and beyond ourselves and our self-serving desires. 19th century aestheticism was not, nor ever could have been, a platform for politics or a basis for social order. Not surprisingly, of course, because it was in essence an ironic repudiation of both of those things. Oscar Wilde discovered this to his cost when in 1895 he found himself prosecuted and convicted for homosexuality, a victim of social intolerance and bigotry wedded to a very real socio-political structure with the authority to enforce its beliefs. Wilde was an artist, not a politician, and his comments on politicians were satire of the sort today we associate with John Oliver or Samantha Bee. To be an artist, he had to be free of mundane constraints as he understood them, hence his rhetorical advocacy of the lie. But paradoxically, in his liberated sexuality and the extravagance of his lifestyle, he lived his truth. In his famous novel, The Picture of Dorian Gray, he explored the destructive alternative, what it might mean to live a lie hidden behind a false front. But for living his truth, what he called the love that dare not speak its name, he spent 2 years in Reading jail. And one lesson to be learned is that none of us lives entirely in the world of fact or in the world of imagination. And what we imagine, our lying, if you like, will almost always have consequences in fact. Now, what are your responsibilities in this context, and why is that an important question to ask at a university convocation? The answer is simple. And in providing it, I will turn to a theme explored nowhere as positively and effectively as in the United States, where a long tradition exists of seeing education and research as the fundamental and indispensable building block for democracy. From the Institute for Democracy and Higher Education at Tufts University this week, there came a condemnation of the disregard for facts and truth evident in the election, and a call for universities, quote, to seize this moment in the nation's history to reflect on their role in strengthening American democracy. While that call emerges from the American Academy and at this particular moment in American history, that reminder that as educated citizens trained in the habits of science and inquiry, we should assume responsibility for the quality of our own democracy. That is a call that needs to be heeded everywhere. Even when lying is the object of our study, as in disciplines like my own, where works of the imagination stand front and center, what we do at university is seek the facts, however we would define them, and try to apprehend truth. Even when our inquiries point to the conclusion that the truth is unknowable, meaning perpetually deferred, or the human condition hopelessly solipsistic, we seek a deeper understanding of those very issues. We inquire into them as in the natural sciences, we inquire into phenomena that stand outside ourselves, our minds, and our imaginations. Facts are neither dull, nor are they absolute, because when interrogated by the mind, they lead to new understandings. And it is that process, the rigorous weighing of evidence and questioning of received wisdom, which opens the way to truth. For researchers, the truth is always provisional, subject to revision as new evidence is amassed and existing evidence analyzed in new ways. And of course, lie and fact come together in the felt truth of art, of music, or literature. As members of this community of scholars, we can and do accept that the truth is complex, relative, and provisional. It is a various, changeable chameleon of a thing that we would likely all define differently. But that does not mean that the fruits of our studies and our research are no better than lies, although that is exactly what is asserted in the new post-truth world, that the facts gleaned from research require no higher priority than lies told in the interests of self-serving politics. Whatever our disciplines, we are all united in our work by the desire to understand, and the products of that desire will advance society by provoking deeper questions. Post-truth utterances, on the other hand, are intended to discourage the spirit of inquiry. And that distinction is critical for all of us and also critical for the good of our society. That is the lesson and also the habit that I hope you will take with you as you leave McMaster. Facts and evidence are important, not merely as the end of our labor, but as the beginning of all further work that matters. No matter what the fashion of the age may be, your responsibility is to serve as ambassadors for truth, carrying with you the tools for understanding our world that you have acquired in the university, and the hope which underpins everything we do in places like this, that rational and creative thought can ultimately make this world a better place. My congratulations and very, very best wishes to you all.
Congratulations to the class of 2016. As a fellow alumna, I'm really looking forward to seeing where you all go from here. Dr. Ten, Dr. Goba, Dr. Nice, congratulations on your accomplishments. As Ms. McQuaig eloquently said, you're now all graduates and members of a wonderful group of alumni. And Dr. Dean, you've given us a lot to think about. And I think his message is so important for today. And I want to take it one level further. And he mentioned in there that what we've become is the politics of emotion. And if you look at, we've always had emotion in politics. But on the whole, it has appealed to our optimism, to our faith in the future. And if you look, whether it's south of the border, whether it's Brexit, whether it's France, whether it's Poland, it now appeals to the worst of us to say we're suffering because other people succeed. Because they're different, we turn on them. And as I have the privilege as the chancellor to grant honorary degrees, I have been amazed over the time that I've done this. As I look at the people we honor, who range from novelists to superb scientists, there's no one group who can claim to add more to society than another. And then I look at the people here and the people that's going across the stage, and although each of you come across the stage because of your own individual accomplishments, you've all been part of an incredibly diverse community here at McMaster. And you know what you've gained from that, whether professionally or personally. And so as, hopefully it won't happen, but possibly will, we see the negative side of the appeal to emotions move north of the border, that you look back on your experience here and evaluate what you're told against what you really know, and as Dr. Dean would say, you check the facts. Your valedictorian said you are the future, and you are, and that gives me hope. And with all of that, I wish you all of the best as you go forth. Congratulations. I would ask that you please remain standing at your seats until the academic procession and the graduates have left the hall. And finally, please join now in the singing of our national anthem. After the singing of the anthem, this convocation stands adjourned.